personal cheating. I said, I'll just take one or two aspirins. And of course, what happens after 4 hours, what happens to the aspirin? It wears off. But of course, the Lord was doing something. I didn't take any more medication that night. I just suffered through the pain. But I said to the Lord in my cell, and as I prayed the second time, I said, Lord, I tell my colleagues, I'm trusting you. And I am doing just that. Saying to God, sometimes the Lord doesn't heal us instantly because he's taking us through a walk of faith. That night I went to bed. The pain was very severe. I turned and tossed all night. My husband would tell me. I could hardly get out of the bed to go to the bathroom. You know, the usual bathroom one. I had to kind of slide out of the bed because if I leaned on the shoulder, it would be so severe. And then the next morning, I had an 8 o'clock class. And the pain was so severe in the morning. I said, oh God, I don't know what to do. But I'm depending upon you. So I put my hand in a sling, and I went to class that morning. The students, of course, it was like, Dr. McCoy, what are you doing here? Why did you come? I said, well, you know, I'm going to be missing another session in a few weeks, and I didn't want this one, so here I am. And so here I was teaching with a hand in a sling, crippled, but trying to do my very best because I didn't want to put the students back. I believe I saw Sister Flo. Florina, I believe she's a witness. She saw me on the Wednesday with this thing in my hand. And just to get my story right, so before I left the home, the pain was so severe, my husband said, you stay home. I will go to work and drop the kids, and then I'll come back, I'll get you so that you can go to the doctor, because he said he could see that I was in pain. My daughter literally had to stand under me, hold this hand up so that I could rip my hair to kind of make sense of my hair so that I could go to work. It was that bad. But I'll tell you the story about the aspirin. So I took the aspirins again that morning before I walked out of the door because of the excruciating pain. And I went to class. And as I said, you know what happens every 4 hours with aspirin, right? It wears off. So I tore at 8 to 10, and if I took the aspirin around 6 o'clock that night, by 10 o'clock, I should have felt that heavy excruciating pain on my shoulder again. So I began to pin down when the Lord healed me. At 10 o'clock, when I walked out of the class, I said, wait a minute, my hand should be hurting me. 11, no pain. 12, no pain. 12 something, my husband called me because he expected me to call him after class. No pain. I said, my dear, I am healed. My staff said, Dr. Micklewhite, what's the problem? She said, they said, you took the sling off your hand. I said, look what I can do. Look what I can do. I waved my hand. Pain was gone. They were telling me you have to go to the doctor, you have to go get an MRI, you have to get a shot all the time in your arm to relax the muscle. And every possible contortion was the advice that they were given to me for the pains like that in your shoulder, that are muscle and nerve related. But thanks to God, I thank the Lord because at 10 o'clock the pain was he is the risen king.
wish that you continue to be prayerful as the senior choir minister to us at this time. Come on, let's welcome the sanctuary choir this time.
Thank you.
around the world. He is a disciple of Jesus Christ and shares the word of God daily with whomever he comes into contact with. Dr. Benedict is married to the wonderful wife, Sister Carolyn Benedict, and they are the proud parents of one son, Cameron Benedict. There's much that I can say about this humble, quiet giant of a man. But it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker and to let you know that he is a child of God. And that is really what matters, that he is a child of God. Please pray for him as he proclaims the word of God. Just before he comes, the praise team will lead us in a time of praise and celebration. So you can stand at this time as we praise, as we worship, and as we magnify the name of the Lord. Come on, church, let's get ready for a time of praise and celebration. After the praise team, you can stand to receive the word of God that will be delivered by Bishop Len, Dr. Glenn. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
I believe you came to praise the Lord. You came to praise him. Turn your neighbor and
he decides to heal us all by himself or with the use of the doctors as he did for me, I believe that he is worthy of the praise. And we have to trust and obey him. And it's amazing what praises can do. You know, you may be feeling arthritis in your shoulder. You may be feeling it in your bones. You may be feeling depressed. But it's amazing what praises can do. When we begin to praise the Lord, Sister Janet, the chains fell off. Because praises connect with God. Tell your neighbor, it's amazing what your praise can do.
scores of young men to the Lord. These young men who perhaps are candidates to commit the next murder, but Lord can turn it around. And let me give God the hallelujah praise. He can turn our country around for His glory. So I don't want you to take your praise for granted, because when we enter into the Holy of Holies, we invoke the presence of God, not only for our church, not only for our home, but for our nation. And so these upper times of
face and the other ministers, their wives. I give God thanks for the opportunity to stand before you, not in the usual capacity for me, but with God's help and His grace and mercy, it will be His will. I can say that confidently because it was just a month ago, a step between me and them. And I know some of you pray. I know some of you pray. Because if you didn't pray and I didn't pray, I wouldn't be standing here before you. And this is no time to stop praying now. This is a difficult moment. You can't leave the work half done. You have to take one step at a time. And prayers, God will help us. Me and you, all of us, we need to pray, you know. Not only I who need prayers, you need prayers as well. One for another, all the time. I woke up 4 o'clock in the morning, given a word that everything was fine. And by 10 o'clock that morning, they had me on a way to leave this place. But God. And I don't bring no message to you this morning. This is not a message of a servant. This is a witness. It's a witness of my life at this time and at this phase. I'm using a little comparison to Philippians because it reflects an important part of life in the history of the New Testament. When St. Paul, in the midst of his letter, you know, he wrote several letters. And this one of those was written from prison. And it's so difficult to write a letter, an epistle any time. These ministers will know what I'm meaning because they have to align themselves according to the topic of what they're doing at the time. But it's even more difficult to write that letter if you're writing it from prison. You're in a difficult place. And nothing there is in support of you. You should hardly even know what I'm talking about. But with God in the vessel, with Jesus Christ as the captain of the ship, some things can happen that don't normally happen. They call them miracles. That's what they call them. They say they're miracles. But we know they are activities of Jesus Christ. He died for us at Calvary. And He does things that man cannot do. I come to witness to you to say that. No matter what man thinks or what he says, he can turn up at any time and change the picture. And when he comes, he does turn the picture around, the story around. Because he comes through prayer. He comes and fills the gap. In this epistle written by St. Paul, Paul makes it very clear. He says, it's not there about me. It's about Jesus Christ in me. It's not about me or you. It's about the Holy Spirit. Do you have that Spirit in you that rose Christ from the dead and changed the lives of human beings? If you don't have that Spirit in you, you need to get it quickly. Because the only way you can stand the test of time is that you need to have that Holy Spirit in you. Paul spoke to the people at Philippi, and he was very confident to them about prayers and being in prayer.
they ought to always pray and not to faint. Always, not sometimes, not when you feel like it, not when you're in trouble, not when it's a difficult situation. You ought always to pray and put yourself in a frame where you can be in touch with God. You see, it's a communication. It's communication. It's not a one-way street. It's only going in one direction. It's going back and forth. You're praying to a mighty Father, and He's answering you in accordance with your prayer. And that is a critical point for us to bear in mind, to understand that when you pray, you to always pray. Don't be anxious about anything. Don't be afraid of this Father that you're going to. Don't be afraid, because He is a wonderful Father, our Father. He didn't say my Father, He says our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You ought to give Him what He deserves. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. You get ready to transform a physical temporal place into a spiritual place. And you can't do that without power. This is not the power that you talk about with BEC. I often tell them, you know, everybody's talking about BEC and BPL nowadays. But every now and again, you get a feeling in this body of ours, a movement in this that is not like BEC. It's a different type of feeling. It's a feeling that comes from the Holy Spirit. And if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you ought to get it. You ought to draw near to God. So from time to time, you can feel this Holy Spirit. And so you can know the comfort of the Holy Spirit. You can enjoy the Holy Spirit. You see, when you say hallelujah, you're not just saying hallelujah just there in a communication. Hallelujah suggests overjoy. It suggests that you have more joy than the average. You're not just happy. You're not just happy. Anybody can be happy. I'm happy. You're happy. But when you say hallelujah, and mark my word, you don't just say it anytime. You don't just say it anytime. When somebody look at you and say hallelujah, there's something different about it. There's something different. He's calling on a force that is not just here. It's another type of force. It's the Holy Spirit that changed the inner man. It's not the man that you were looking at, that I am looking at. It's the man that changes inside. You know, I talked about people, and they're interesting to me, because communication until recently was believed that you can't communicate unless you touch someone. You can't communicate unless you get on the telephone. But nowadays with Wi-Fi and Instagram and other things, tweet. Even the President of the United States tweeting. Everybody believes you can do these things all in life. Let me tell you something else. There's something else you can do. This Holy Spirit that I'm talking to you about. You can act with that Holy Spirit. You can call on Him and He will answer. You just need to line up your life right and line up everything right. And the same way that you can get all of these things that you thought you couldn't get, the Holy Spirit can work on you too. And He can change the situation for you. You need the Holy Spirit. You need the power of the Holy Spirit in you. I'll tell you something. Every now and again, my hair stands on end. I don't know if it ever happened to you. When the word is going on, and when people are talking about real life actions, my hair stands on end. And God is using you. He is acting in you at the time. There's more to life than the things that we see. There's more to life than the things
things that we look at. Life consists of many things. The inner man is beyond our imagination. We have no knowing what will happen next. We have no idea, but God knows. You know, we believe we know everything. We believe we have all the knowledge. We believe we can, there's nothing that we don't know. We predict. I'm a part of so many advanced things. You see here, advanced things. But I didn't know when I was going to go. Not the certain fact that I knew all these things. I woke up. I have put more than thousands of people to sleep and wake them up. No problem. But when I was going, I didn't know. I said, when I was going, I wouldn't know. And they couldn't wake me up. But somebody could wake me up. I had to know who was that. You got to understand that if I didn't know who could do that, I wouldn't be standing before you. It takes time to make the connection and understand that when God is in the picture, when God speaks, no man can answer. Only God knows what he will do. And I'm saying to you, he called me. They were calling me. They were saying, Dr. Benjamin, Dr. Benjamin, they told me. No answer. I said, no answer. I said, no answer. But when the time is right, the master walked into the picture. He walked into the picture. Not only that, he called me. And there was nothing missing or wrong.